And once again, good morning students. This is the third video on the scapula where I'm going to show you the particular feature of scapula. Particular features means I'm going to show you the attachment of the muscles, origin as well as insertion. Then I will show you the attachment of some important ligaments. And lastly, I will show you the blood vessels and nerves which are in relation to this bone. So coming to the muscular attachment, and that's two on its costal surface. You can see that this is the costal surface, and this scapula which I am using it for this attachment, this is the scapula belonging onto the right side. This is the medial border, this is the median plane, for example. Then this is the right side, okay? It is, so coming to the costal surface, this is the costal surface and the coracoid process is here. This fossa is called as the subscapular fossa, which we have already known. Then this fossa gives attachment, subscapular fossa, from its, except to an area close to the this glenoid cavity. Okay, the rest of the surface, including that of the medial, close to the medial border where trapezius will be attached, and including close to this bar-like bone on the very close to the lateral border, everything gives origin to the subscapularis muscle. Now I may show you the subscapularis muscle from an atlas so that you will give a better better idea. Similarly, on the medial surface of the scapula, there is here on costal surface, there is the attachment of the serratus anterior muscle. More big mass is attached to the inferior angle and to that of the superior angle. The, what is called as the eight digitation of the serratus anterior muscles are attached on the costal surface close to the medial border. Okay. Then there is a muscle which may also gain attachment here, and this muscle is called as the omohyoid muscle, close to the suprascapular notch. This is the inferior belly of the omohyoid near the suprascapular notch here. Now these are the three muscles which are attached onto the costal surface. Now I will show you the attachment of this muscle and their extent in an atlas. Okay. I am using the atlas for this muscular attachment. This is an atlas of the anatomy, and this is by Gilroy, that is published by the Theme. And I like this atlas because it shows a very clear-cut description from where this muscle comes and where they go. Now you can see in this description what we have learned about the three muscles. Now this is the serratus anterior muscle. See, this is cut end, okay? So it is attached to the medial border of the scapula here, okay? It is insertion, okay? Because origin is from the ribs. And then this is the subscapularis muscle, which takes origin from the whole of the costal surface, and then the fibers, they run upwards and laterally. So this is the subscapularis muscle, which has taken origin from this costal surface, okay, which I have shown here. The large area of the origin is here. So these are the muscles which are onto the costal surface, right? I will show you further. Let's go to the next part, and that is the muscular attachment onto the dorsal surface. So now this is the dorsal surface of the scapula, and we come to the attachment onto the dorsal surface. Now in the supraspinous fossa, see this fossa, there is the origin of a muscle which is called as the supraspinatus muscle. Supraspinatus muscle, this area. Okay, on your diagram, in a rough triangular diagram, you can also just at the same time keep on drawing this supraspinatus muscle. Okay, or if you are having a scapula, just with the chalk piece you draw. And then below this spinous process, okay, this is the attachment of the infraspinatus muscle. The whole area gives attachment to the infraspinatus, that is origin. It is origin. And see that this origin is extending on the undersurface of the spine, that is the inferior surface of the spinous process. This is the crest of the spine. this is also extending on to the superior surface of the spine up to the upper lip or the upper border of the crest of the spine. Now these are two important muscles, supraspinatus and infraspinatus muscle. Then I will show you a muscle origin from the infraglenoid tubercle. See this was the infraglenoid tubercle. And from this infraglenoid tubercle, there is the origin of the long head of tricep. I will just show you. The long head of the triceps takes origin from the infraglenoid tubercle. Then on the dorsal aspect, close to the lateral border, there is the origin of the other two muscles, what is called as the teres minor. So the two bellies of teres minor, they are taking origin here. See this teres minor. There is a groove here, okay, where I am just putting my finger, and through this groove between the two bellies of the teres minor, it is the passage of the circumflex scapular artery. That's the discontinuity is seen here. Then to this large area here, onto the dorsal surface, close to the lateral border, this whole surface gives origin to muscle, what is called as the teres major. So teres minor are here, then this is the teres major, and this is the long head of the tricep. This is the infraspinatus, this is the supraspinatus muscle. Then coming to the border, that is the medial border, where the other muscles are attached here, and they are quite thin muscle coming from mostly from the midline structure, that is the spinous process and other area transverse process of the spine. And right from superior angle here onto the dorsal surface up to the root of the spine, this is called as the root of the spine, right here. So up to the root of the spine, the whole border, okay, dorsal, it gives an attachment. I'm sorry, this is the insertion, so I should use this blue color chalk. This is the insertion of the muscle, what is called as levator scapulae. This is called as levator scapulae. And just from this small area opposite to the root of the spine here, this area is small area, again there is insertion of the rhomboides minor. This is the rhomboides minor. In the rest of the medial border here gives attachment to the structure, I may say to a muscle, which is called as rhomboides major. So here is the levator scapulae, rhomboides minor, and here is the rhomboides major muscle. These are insertion on the medial border onto the costal surface, onto the cost. Let me show you some of this muscle first before I come to the attachment of the processes, okay? And for this, I will use again the same atlas, and I am thankful and acknowledge the use of this atlas with thanks to the Thime, okay, whom atlas I am using it here. And you will see this on the page, some further page where you can see the I think it is here, yes, this is, you can see here the three muscles which were attached to the lateral border. See this lateral border, I mean medial border, the dorsal aspect of the medial border was here, and here is this muscle attached, is the levator scapulae. Okay, I will just move this, I have a small space here to move. Okay, so this is the levator scapulae muscle, which is attached to here to the medial border here on its dorsal surface. Then these are the two muscle, rhomboides minor and rhomboides minor. So this is the minor and this is the rhomboides major muscle. You can see here also the supraspinatus, and this muscle here, this supraspinatus, and this bulky muscle here is the infraspinatus, which takes origin from the infraspinous fossa. Then you can also see a muscle here which is taking origin from the inferior angle dorsal aspect, and this muscle is the teres major. So this muscle going towards the humerus is the teres major muscle. I will use this diagram again here, though I have not told you, but this is the inferior lip of the crest of the spine. Okay, so this was the crest Okay, anterior posterior border or crest, it has two lip, a superior lip and an in. So this inferior lip in its almost whole extent and then extending onto the lateral border of the acromion process, the whole thing, okay, from here to here where I am moving. This gives origin to a muscle, and this muscle is called as the, which muscle? Deltoid. This is a long origin of the scapular fibers. And then I have told you in the last video that there is a clavicular head of the origin of deltoid. You can see this in this diagram. See this? This is the lower lip, okay? Right up to the lateral margin of the acromion process. The whole thing is giving origin to this very strong multipinnate muscle, okay? And this is the deltoid muscle. Similarly, on the superior lip of the acromion, I mean, say medial border of the acromion process, and then the rest of the superior lip of the this crest of the spine or spinous process. Okay, here is, sorry, this is the insertion. Here is the insertion of a muscle which comes from the neck, and this is called as the trapezius muscle. Okay, don't be afraid, you will have to learn it again and again, and then only you will be able to remember. So best way is that I told you, draw the diagram simple and keep on just drawing these muscles. Okay, now let us come to the supraglenoid tubercle. Okay, onto this bone, I will tell you, show you something again from this atlas. Okay, now this is the supraglenoid tubercle is here, and this supraglenoid tubercle, it gives origin to a muscle, okay, called as the long head of biceps, and it is intracapsular origin, within the joint cavity it comes. So this is the long head of the biceps. I will show you the diagram, and the margin of this glenoid cavity, this oval shape, this will give attachment to the fibrous capsule. Now then, infraglenoid tubercle, I have already told you that this gives origin to that of the triceps muscle, long head of the triceps. Coming to the attachment of the tip of the coracoid process. See this tip of the coracoid process? This gives origin to two muscles from the tip. It is the short head of the biceps and the coracobrachialis. Short head of the biceps and the coracobrachialis. So I will show you the short head of the biceps and coracobrachialis and the long head of the biceps, how it is taking origin. Let's go to some page here where it is. Just a minute, I will just reach to here. Yes, this has come. Now see this diagram, and in this diagram you can see this is the coracoid process, and this coracoid process here, the tip is giving origin to the short head of the biceps, okay, and this the supraglenoid tubercle is hidden here, and if it will be exposed, I will show you. There is a tendinous origin of this long head of the biceps, and both the biceps head, then they unite to form a single valley. Now in this diagram you can see very well the attachment of the long head of the triceps, okay, which is taking origin from the infraglenoid tubercle, which is clearly seen from the dorsal aspect. Okay, so this is the triceps long head. Let us see the coracobrachialis. If I can get a diagram of coracobrachialis, which takes origin from the tip of the coracoid process, I will show you. But before that, you can also see an attachment here from that of the coracoid process, anterior aspect of the coracoid process, you see, and this muscle which is going from the ribs, okay, and this is the third, fourth and fifth ribs, and this tendon goes and gets attachment to the coracoid process, and this is present deep to the pectoralis major, and this muscle is called as the pectoralis minor. So on coracoid process there is also attachment beside on the tip of the coracobrachialis and short head of biceps, it is the pectoralis minor is also attached. Okay, so you will have to study it again and again, then only you will be able to understand. So don't get afraid, gradually you are going to learn all these. Okay, all these, I think these are the muscles attachment onto the scapula. Okay, so we were dealing with this scapula, muscle attachment. Let us come to the ligaments first. Okay, and ligaments, I have told you about the capsular ligament of the shoulder joint, which is attached to the margins here. See this? This is the glenoid cavity, and here is the attachment of the capsule of the shoulder joint on the outer margin of this glenoid cavity, right? Then we go to a ligament, what is called as the suprascapular ligament, and this is just a fibrous band onto the top of this suprascapular notch. Okay, on that I have shown you, this is the supra, near the superior border, at the base of the coracoid process, this notch, and a small fibrous band will bridge it, and then it will convert it into foramina. Okay, that is called the suprascapular foramina. Now, there are the structures which will go through this suprascapular notch and the foramina, if it is there, are converted through the supraspinous ligament. Now, I will show you the supraspinous ligament and the structures which are passing above and below to this from my own book on the osteology. Okay, and this was published by the PP. Can you see this here? This is the PP publication, Human Osteology, by myself. Okay, now you can see here in I will just show you, if you are not able to see, just concentrate here. This is the superior border, and there is a ligament here. This is called as the suprascapular ligament, and deeper structure which will be going through it, it is called as the, it is suprascapular nerve, which I will again tell you. Okay, so this is the, the suprascapular ligament. Okay, after capsular ligament, which is attached to the margin of the glenoid cavity, let us come to the two other ligament, and these two other ligament are coracoacromial ligament. First ligament is coraco. See, this is the glenoid cavity, the coracoid process, and this is the acromion process. We are seeing the scapula from the lateral aspect, and there extend a strong ligament from the undersurface of the acromion process, okay, towards the coracoid process, towards the coracoid anteriorly. And this forms an arch, you can see here. The undersurface of the acromion process and coracoacromial ligament right up to the coracoid process, they are forming an arch, and this is a very strong arch. It forms a socket for the head of the humerus. So if there is the displacement of the head of the humerus takes place upward, okay, then it cannot go beyond this, okay, because it is well protected by here. So upward displacement of shoulder joints are not seen because of this coracoacromial ligament. That is the importance of coracoacromial. It is in green color, okay. Then we have already seen about this ligament, and this ligament is called as the coracoclavicular ligament, okay, coracoclavicular ligament, which has the two parts, conoid part and the trapezoid. This is the trapezoid part and this is the conoid part. We have also learned about it into the clavicle, under surface of the lateral one third of the clavicle. This is the coracoid process, okay. Now, the structures, nerves and vessels which are in relation to the scapula, one is seen here. This is in the suprascapular ligament, and below that this is the suprascapular notch through which passing is the nerve, and this is the suprascapular nerve. Above it is the vessels, that is artery and vein, and this is also known as suprascapular vessel. Now these vessels, they pass through this notch, are the foramina, first into the supraspinous fossa. You see this notch? Okay, you can see this notch. Then they pass into the supraspinous fossa. Then they pass through the spinoglenoid notch. And through the spinoglenoid notch, then they come to the infraspinatus fossa. So they have a long course from the notch to the infraspinatus fossa. Right, I hope you have understood one relation. Then let us come to the other blood vessels. And now one is again shown here. This is the scapula, the dorsal aspect, and in this dorsal aspect of the scapula, you are seeing the same that is supra-scapular artery and supra-scapular nerve now lies in the foramina above the, below the ligament, and the artery and vein lies above it, okay? Then they from supra-spinatus fossa through the spinoglenoid notch, they come to the infraglenoid fossa where they break up into the subscapularis muscle, infraspinatus muscle, okay, into many branches, right? Then there is another artery which is, I have already told you, circumflex scapular artery, and this passes between the two digitation or two heads of the teres minor, right? And this also breaks up. And then there is a third set of the nerves and blood vessels which pass along the medial border of the scapula. See, this is the medial border, and this is called as the dorsal scapular nerves and artery. Okay, now the three arteries, suprascapular, dorsal scapular and circumflex scapular, they break up into many branches on both the surface, costal and dorsal surface, and they anastomose with each other, okay? And their anastomosis is important anastomosis, because you will learn later when you will go to the joint or in general anatomy lectures, you must have seen that. The synovial joints, large synovial joint, they are always associated with the arterial anastomosis around the joint. So this is an arterial anastomosis, say for example, around the shoulder joint, okay? This completes your scapula, but let us come here, since diagram is here, for the ossification, the scapula ossifies, okay? Here with the one primary center which appears in the 8th week of intrauterine life. The rest of many centers are there, say about 7 centers are there, 2 for the, for the acromion process, 2 for coracoid process, 1 for the medial border of the scapula, and 1 for the inferior angle, and another for the this glenoid cavity, okay? So these are called as secondary center, except this one for the body of the scapula. They appear near puberty and fuses. The first center to fuse is with this lower center of the coracoid process with the glenoid cavity or the body here, okay, at the age of 16 years, while the other centers, okay, they fuse with the primary center at the age of 20 years of age. Now, this completes the scapula in the three videos. Thank you very much.